This is Nigel Farage. And this is me. I've been following him for 6 months, trying to find out what's beneath the studio makeup. I follow him on the campaign trail.
That woman said to me, haven't you gone for a drink yet?
I get his response to events as they happen.
There have been weasels all through the course of history.
I go with him back to the city to meet his city slicker chums.
Making lots of money?
I'm trying.
I might have a beer, you know.
He takes me to Strasbourg to see a side of the European Union you don't normally see.
Just follow me. Say nothing.
I spent half my bloody life out here.
We're not allowed in here.
No, of course not. No. Look out, the heavies are coming.
Présence, s'il vous plaît. Non.
People say he's turning British politics upside down. He's threatening to take Britain out of Europe and wants to bring down the EU.
I'm surrounded by people that hate me.
But I want to know, who's the man behind the mayhem?
The question that I want to ask, that we're all going to ask, is who are you?
My name is Martin Durkin. I used to be a fashionable young left-wing filmmaker. I'm now a wicked middle-aged libertarian. It's 4:45 in the morning, September the 20th, and I'm waiting outside ITV studios for Nigel Farage. Until recently, he came to interviews alone and on public transport. Now he has a driver and a minder.
It's a busy day for you,
I think so. Yeah.
He's come for a chat on the Daybreak sofa, his first TV interview of the day.
It's always a busy day now.
There are many more to follow.
I remember Farage sitting outside a pub in Westminster. He'd be sitting there on his own. Nobody talked to him. Now, question time, rolling out the red carpet to him.
30 seconds.
He is a big media political star.
A quick interview with ITN.
Love it.
Then a high-speed car ride to the BBC studios in Westminster. Farage is a man in demand. According to a recent poll, he's going to win the upcoming Euro elections.
I think if UKIP come top in the European elections, which I believe they will, there's going to be a tremendous upheaval in our politics, which is incredibly exciting.
It's an astonishing moment.
Off to the radio station, LBC.
I should say we have a Channel 4 film crew filming us. That's a sign of how far UKIP's come over the last year.
A report of a poll in The Independent says that UKIP is now Britain's favourite party. And much of this is down to its leader.
He's not handsome, he's not sexy, he's not charismatic. So what's the appeal?
He is an outsider. He thinks there are votes in being an outsider. And actually, right now, he is absolutely correct.
Didn't go to university, you know, set up his own party. Completely different.
He talks from the gut, and he doesn't edit himself. He doesn't say anything that's career safe.
Who would you prefer to see as Prime Minister, David Cameron or Ed Miliband?
Give me a coin. I mean, they're both greenies. They both want us to be governed by Brussels.
I think they're attracted to the drama, this swaggering cowboy.
I like Nigel Farage an awful lot. I don't think I'd vote for him.
Well, he was fine.
Thank you, absolutely.
I might vote for him just to spite other people.
Farage has been invited to the comedy club in Manchester for a beer and fag night with Mark Littlewood, head of the Institute of Economic Affairs.
Successive bourgeois governments, we could put it like this, are telling the working class how to behave, are cutting down on their smoking, are cutting down on their drinking. Here along comes a politician who unapologetically does both.
Farage uses smoking and drinking as a weapon.
Cheers on
that's
that point. Lovely to see you all.
That's why we brought you.
And I asked him where the ashtray was, and apparently it's against the law now.
This is not a politician. He's a showman. Why are we taking him seriously?
But where does all this devil-may-care debauchery and flamboyance come from? Nigel Farage was born 50 years ago in the not remotely racy village of Down in Kent.
14th century?
No, this is 13th century. Because
he's not. Apart from the fact that Darwin lived here, the village is completely ordinary. Farage knows it like the back of his hand. That's because he's never moved out. He still lives round the corner from his mother.
I felt growing up here in a small village, I mean, we would go off with our
sandwiches and air rifles or whatever it is and wander through the woods or, you know, a tremendous amount of freedom.
And your father is a stockbroker heading off to London every day?
Yeah, we are a middle-class southern family. That's where I come from. There's no point pretending to be anything other than that.
Farage says that as a youth, he was bolshy, perverse, doolally and normal. At 10, he is sent to Dulwich College public school, where he excels at sport...
T1, T2.
...but not much else. But there is one key moment at school which will shape his future, and that's when he reads the great libertarian treatise On Liberty by John Stuart Mill.
That was a really important moment because it was something that made me understand how we ought to live together in society, how we ought to have mutual respect for each other, but how we ought to be free as people within reason to do what we want to do without being impinged upon by government and everybody else. And that, I think, has stuck with me all the way through. I hate big government. I can't stand being told what to do. And look at the world we live in now. I mean, speed cameras everywhere. And, you know.
At 18, Farage does not go to university. Instead, he heads off to work in the City of London. When he gets fed up with politics, he still comes here to drink with his old city chums.
I do occasionally like to come back to the city for a dose of common sense and a good laugh. People who work in the city have got a sense of humour. And I guess in politics they used to have, but not this long.
Farage takes me to the Metal Exchange, where he was a broker. As we arrive, he bumps into an old pal having a sneaky gasper outside.
Yeah, okay. Good. Business
nice to
good.
See you.
Business
well,
good.
Yeah, not too bad.
Making lots of money.
I'm trying.
Hi, Birchie. All right. Just having a quick.
How are you anyway? You're all right.
All right. Yeah. Yeah.
Farage is often attacked as a little Englander, but as a broker here, he was at the centre of global trade, buying and selling various metals in huge quantities on behalf of clients all around the world.
The world price for copper and aluminium and lead and zinc and nickel and tin, the daily world trading price is settled here between 12:30 and 1:15 every single day.
Farage spent almost 20 years here, and it turned him into an unswerving champion of global free trade.
The world came here to trade. It wasn't just France and Germany, it was Chile and Australia and America and, of course, nowadays China. But it wasn't just this. There was coffee exchanges and cocoa exchanges and sugar exchanges and rubber exchanges and tea auctions. I hate when I hear this pejorative term, banker. For anyone that works in the City of London, you know, there are a dozen different industries and actually London is still the world leader in these things and we should be rather prouder of it than we are.
But for many of Farage's critics, his city slicker background counts against him.
One part of the intelligentsia in this country don't really like commerce. They don't really like trade. They think that, you know, capitalism is quite vulgar, quite rough. You know, it's about people who can't really be controlled, people who aren't maybe as intelligent or educated as them, actually making much more money than them, and that can't possibly be fair.
Nigel went out into the real world. He understands how money is made, how prosperity is created.
He may know about making money. That doesn't make you a good statesman.
When I'd arrived here from school, we were heading towards Big Bang. Change was in the air. I mean, revolutionary change. You know, the old school tie was thrown out of the window. It didn't matter who you were or where you came from. If you were good at it, you got paid for doing it. It was just the most incredibly exciting period of time. And, you know, the pop stars even dressed like city brokers. I absolutely loved it.
After a couple of pints, Farage shows me where he still comes for chump chops at lunchtime.
Oh, I spent half my bloody life up here. How are you? All right?
I'm good.
Let me see.
And you?
Yeah, everything well?
Yeah, very well, good. Thank you. You lunching today?
I don't know whether we've got time, actually. We're probably just having...
5:30.
But I might have a beer, you know.
Another pint and a bottle of red. Like lots of city traders back in the 80s, Farage liked to drink. Like lots of city traders, he loved Thatcher and hated the European Union.
The European Union is fundamentally at odds with the city. Bureaucrats love bureaucracy. Planners love planning. You can't reconcile this bureaucratic approach, which doesn't like markets, with the reality of what's happening in the city.
Over two large glasses of port, Farage takes me round the corner to an old coffee house. It was in places like this, centuries ago, that city trading began.
European Union is. Sort of central government and five-year plans and bureaucracy and control. And I think an ethos that is anti-capitalist and anti-democratic in every way goes against everything that's been here since 1652.
It was Margaret Thatcher's opposition to the European Union which in effect ended her political career. It was John Major's signing of the Maastricht Treaty which started Nigel Farage's.
UKIP was formed in September 93 and this new party was looking for a candidate, so I put my hand up. I was UKIP's first ever adopted candidate and I found I rather liked it.
In 1999, Farage is elected an MEP and trades his city career for a life on the road. It's 4:30 in the morning in the middle of December and I'm with Farage on the M20 heading towards the Channel Tunnel on our way to the European Parliament in Strasbourg. It's tricky filming with Farage. He hates to be pinned down. When he goes to Europe, though it takes longer, he prefers the freedom of travelling by car.
I'm doing, you know, 30,000 miles a year on the roads in the UK, back and forth to Brussels and Strasbourg, plus quite a few train journeys as well.
It was his heroine, Margaret Thatcher, who was behind the construction of the Channel Tunnel, and Farage rather likes it.
I love Europe, it's great. I've worked for French companies, I've married a German woman. I'm completely pro-European.
But at the border checkpoint, there are no guards, and he goes through without showing his passport.
When I drive my car onto the shuttle, there's something still quite exciting about it, even though I've been doing it every week for the last 15 years. I adore Europe within a tiny geography. You get different languages, different cultures, different histories, different wines, different cheeses, different people. What I can't abide is this project to harmonize it, homogenize it, pasteurize it.
It was a big selling point of the EEC, as it used to be called, that it would open up the European economy. But Farage thinks it's done the exact opposite.
There's a big wall that's increasingly being built around the European Union, diminishing our opportunity to have free trade in goods and services with the rest of the world, particularly with agricultural products and food products, where, you know, if poor black African countries try and sell their goods to us, we put massive tariffs on them. The EU, far from being a free trade zone, increasingly resembles a protectionist bloc that is trying to put its hands over its ears and shout loudly, globalisation is not happening. Sorry, guys, it is. And I want the United Kingdom to be able to take huge advantage of that. Can we call William Hague a Eurosceptic? I can answer that.
Day is only just flickering into life as Farage leaves the train and heads for the A26. For political reasons, the European Parliament is based in Brussels, Luxembourg and Strasbourg. It's a 5.5-hour drive to Strasbourg, but Farage doesn't seem to mind. He's planning to make trouble when he gets there. Over the centuries, the quaint picture book town of Strasbourg has bounced between Germany and France. Right now it's French, but could hardly look more German. To the northeast of town is the Euro Quarter, a few square miles of glass and concrete modernist buildings housing various European institutions.
Here we are.
This one is the new main building of the Parliament, where Farage has his office.
This is amazing.
Yeah, it is. It's designed to impress, isn't it?
The European Union is made up of the European Commission, the Council of the European Union, the European Council, the European Parliament, and a large number of other councils, agencies, and directorates.
Thousands of people everywhere you look. I don't know what they all do, really. Director of Logistics. Oh.
Many European bodies are based elsewhere, like Brussels and Luxembourg, but also have offices here too.
That's the paperclip department, I'm certain of that.
Various buildings here are connected by a large number of corridors, bridges, lifts and tunnels.
Where do we go, Orly?
Lift 5.
Lift 5?
Yeah.
Farage is lost.
Where do we go?
We've gone down the wrong corridor and ended up in the Council of Europe.
I've never been in this corridor before.
The Council of Europe is not part of the EU and should not be confused with the European Council or the Council of the European Union, which are...
entirely separate staff, entirely different backup.
Where are we heading?
I'm not sure. Oh, my God. No, that's outside.
Farage decides to slip out for a quick cig and to get his bearings.
Just gone up.
I have to confess, my knowledge now hits the buffers. That one's only been up 18 months. I don't know what it is. But I can see an EU flag on the outside, so all's well.
He spots the European Court of Human Rights. Now he knows where he is.
So that... and what's that?
That's the Parliament. That's where we started.
All right.
We've come so far, we need to get a train back from a station called The Rights of Man.
Where do we buy tickets?
Yeah, is it a free tram?
It'll be all right.
We have no tickets, but Farage doesn't seem to care.
Just follow me, say nothing, see what happens.
There's a strict ban on filming in the Parliament chamber.
But this is it.
But Farage doesn't seem to care about that either.
We're not allowed in here,
Leslie. No, of course not, no.
This is where the MEPs come to vote. It looks like a giant spaceship. Around the edges are black stripes, which turn out to be darkened glass.
There, I see. Latvia.
Behind the glass are rows of booths, where a small legion of translators do their work.
It's quite an industry.
Along with the MEPs, four presidents of the EU can attend the European Parliament. But even senior political journalists in Britain struggle to name them or describe their function.
You are a defender of the EU, and you are a senior political journalist in Britain, but you don't know what the job title is of Martin Schulz or Herman Van Rompuy. What is it?
No, he's the guy who's very good on figures and numbers, and I know who they are. I know, I listen to them.
What are their job titles? What do they do?
Oh, they're part of the hierarchy. I don't know.
Even for semi-anoraks like myself, I find it baffling, this vast array of characters and the different relationships between them and the multiple tiers of responsibility. Don't test me on these people. Who are they?
I'm astounded that a journalist who makes his living at investigation isn't fully informed and hasn't got access to the very, very effective...
You know, even senior politicians in this country that we've asked don't know who a lot of these people are or what their job descriptions are. Senior journalists, you just don't know.
They're ignoramuses, then.
We don't know who they are. We know nothing about them. We haven't examined them. They haven't been held up to scrutiny by us. And so people of whom we've never heard are suddenly taking the most enormous decisions that affect us in our daily lives.
This is me. Mr. Brosseau's just there. And Mr. Schulz, the president, is just there.
Just who the hell do you think you people are?
And then when Mr. Van Rompuy comes, he sits just over there.
None of you have been elected. None of you actually have any democratic legitimacy.
And on this bench, I'm surrounded by people that hate me.
Yes, it'll mean you lose your job, Mr. Brosseau. Yes, I want you sacked, Mr. Schulz, as well. I want you all fired.
When you first arrived, you said that someone described this as a charade.
Oh, as I walked
what
in...
What do you mean?
As I walked in and took my seat, there was a Danish socialist Eurosceptic veteran who I'd never met before, and he stood up and shook my hand and he said, "Welcome to this charade." And what he meant was, this is the only parliament that the world's ever invented where you cannot initiate legislation, propose legislation, or even the repeal of legislation. All of that comes from the unelected European Commission.
The Parliament in Brussels is not a parliament at all. It's a committee. It's a toothless committee. It's actually got less power than the House of Lords.
The European Parliament is not a parliament in the sense of the British Parliament, is it? It doesn't either have parliamentary privilege in the same way as the House
of Lords. Not in the
same way, no. It can't instigate legislation.
No, that's right. But in the last 10 years, Parliament has had much stronger rights of consultation and involvement, which is much more democratic.
Please do not think this is a proper Parliament exercising real democracy, because it is no such thing.
This European Union is the new communism. It is power without limits.
Look out, the heavies are coming.
We're not allowed here.
No. Well, the great thing is never ask for permission, just do things and then apologise afterwards. It works terribly well. We better bugger off.
Yeah.
It's a bit like clocking in and clocking out, but
Pardon, non. Pardon, excusez-moi. Pas filmé à liste de présence, s'il vous plaît. Non.
When Farage signs his name at the door, we're finally spotted by security. Farage quickly slips away and appears busy on the phone.
Right, coffee, come on.
No, it's too early.
Farage is planning to make a very rude speech about the new president of the Council of the European Union, who is Greek. He's so distracted, he's forgotten that smoking is illegal in public buildings.
I'm going to go down the line of the violence on the street, the neo-Nazis are on the march. No worries, the Greeks are in charge.
Farage has been famous for his rude speeches ever since the appointment of the current president of the European Council, Herman Van Rompuy.
We were told that when we had a president, we'd see a giant global political figure, the man that would represent all of us on the world stage. Well, I'm afraid what we got was you. And I don't want to be rude, but you have the charisma of a damp rag and the appearance of a low-grade bank clerk. And the question that I want to ask, that we're all going to ask, is who are you? I'd never heard of you. Nobody in Europe had ever heard of you. I would like to ask you, President, who voted for you? And what mechanism? Oh, I know democracy's not popular with you lot. And what mechanism do the peoples of Europe have to remove you? Is this European democracy? Sir, you have no legitimacy in this job at all. We don't know you. We don't want you. And the sooner you're put out to grass, the better.
The speech became an immediate YouTube hit, and there were more to follow.
Baroness Cathy Ashton. She's even less well-known than Herman Van Rompuy. That takes some doing, doesn't it? So what are you saying? That this isn't quite as bad as the USSR?
Who's in charge?
You're rather noisy about it, aren't you? You are very, very dangerous people indeed.
You should all be fired.
I think we should be against.
Yeah, we're against
them. Farage is meeting other UKIP MEPs.
This is important.
This is tariffs on agricultural products.
Yes.
They're discussing another raft of laws submitted by the European Commission for the Parliament to ratify.
Here we are, discussing tariffs on beef, pig meat, poultry meat, wheat, brands, and all sorts of things that are coming from outside the European Union. Whichever way you look at this, it is beyond doubt that food prices are higher inside the European Union than they could be outside the European Union.
So I think maybe that should be a no vote
then at the end. So do I.
Ed Miliband says there's a cost of living crisis, but the EU prevents consumers from buying less expensive goods from outside Europe.
No, it doesn't. As long as those goods can conform to the standards of food and product health and safety, especially safety, and size, which is regulated for the protection of the consumer, of course they can be sold.
Because of the European Union's stupid rules against imports, we're paying more for our food, we're paying more for our wine, we're paying more for our cars, we're paying more for just about every good we buy.
It's not easy holding back the tide of new EU laws.
I'm perfectly happy with that.
Over the course of a year, an average MEP gets to speak in Parliament for just 60 minutes.
I'd personally be happy to leave the whole lot.
And yet the volume of legislation is impressive. During this session, votes are being taken at the rate of 4 a minute.
The first part, those in favour. Against, abstentions, adopted. The second part, those in favour.
It's estimated that around half new laws introduced in Britain come from the European Union.
So much that is completely unreported that goes on in Brussels is actually hugely important to us.
Recital G, the first part, those in favour. Against, abstentions, adopted. Second part, those in favour. Against, abstentions, adopted, Mr. Brody.
Down in the press department, journalists are struggling to keep up. For this one, it's all too much. Herman Kelly is an Irish journalist who now handles press relations for Farage and other Eurosceptic MEPs.
The EU has many weapons. One is to subvert people's democracy by boring them to tears. The personalities are boring, the legislation is incredibly boring, and basically that's how they operate.
Democracy only works if the electorate knows who's governing them, if they can monitor what they're doing, if there's a connection between what they say they're going to do and what they actually do. At the European level, democracy breaks down.
If you're in the pub, somebody says, you know what, have you seen that new law about goods lorries? No? What's that? Oh, well, we can't now do X and Y. Oh, really? Why is that? I don't know. It's Brussels, isn't it? Brussels. Nobody knows. Whereas if they tried to do it here, there'd be a massive debate about it, loads of phone-ins. We just say, I'll tell you what, I'll have another pint of IPA, I think.
It's the end of another parliamentary session. The limousines line up to ferry away the politicians and bureaucrats. But Farage takes me to a bar with some other Eurosceptics where they make jokes about the futility of the European Parliament.
Early morning aerobics.
Farage is in a good mood. He can smell victory. A referendum on Europe at some point is looking increasingly likely, and he believes he's winning the argument.
The positions that the Eurosceptics have held have now become majority opinion. People have come to expect that their voice should matter in politics, and in the EU, they can't see that happening.
Farage heads back to Britain, where the Euro election campaign is starting to heat up. I'm back in Nigel Farage's home village. He says it's not just the European superstate he wants to destroy. He has plans for the British state too. I want to know where he gets his ideas and inspiration, so we head off to the Georgian Dragon.
That's what.
Farage has been a regular here for more than 30 years.
Good man, nice to see you.
Everybody here knows him. And he knows everybody.
He's going very well.
You're speaking to
me. Oh, Tom. I mean, where will we not talk, you know?
Other politicians have focus groups. It seems that you have the pub.
Well, I mean, every pub's a parliament. It's in pubs where people get together from the community. They talk about who they're going to vote for, who the England football manager should be.
Yeah. If Farage is going to remain successful, he has got to remain focused on those people almost in his village. Hard-working, pay their taxes, do the traditional things, which actually people sneer at.
People say there's not enough detail in your manifesto.
Well, they'll tear us to bits if there's no detail. They'll tear us to bits if there is detail. But I think the voters know exactly what we stand for.
According to the pub politics in the Georgian Dragon, it seems that the state is too big, too bossy, too greedy.
If you lift the shackles of taxation and regulation off the backs of ordinary folk in this country, they go out there, they borrow money, they take risks. Wealth isn't created by governments, it's created by people.
Early April is
it. It is common sense in the saloon bar that saving is better than borrowing and you should live within your means.
Politicians always say it's not like running your own household. And look where we are today.
Our national debt is now about 1.4 trillion. It's got up by 40% during the lifetime of this particular administration. We are going to have to find ways to reduce government spending.
I'm hopeful that a Farage character, if he does get some power, turns out to be quite mean and sort of rather curmudgeonly when it comes to spending the taxpayers' money. It would be fantastic just to say, do you know what? We've had a look at the budget this year and we have decided, actually, that we're not spending anything.
Farage wants to radically shrink the welfare state and take us out of the EU. These ideas chime with lots of ordinary people, but not with our high-minded, big state-loving intelligentsia.
If you express support for certain ideas, for example, Euroscepticism or lower taxes, you're looked down upon by certain parts of the establishment, by certain parts of the elite. It's not just that they disagree with you, they make you feel that you're morally inferior. And I think that's what Farage and some others are tapping into.
I think the political class and the entitlement class have an absolute abhorrence of the values of ordinary people. They find them, they're holding their noses.
It's the UKIP annual conference, and the question of immigration is high on the agenda. I've been trying to work out why UKIP supporters hold the views they do on immigration. But as I wander round, I begin to understand. The party is celebrating its 20th birthday, but it's a long time since most of its members celebrated their 20th birthdays. A recent poll found that 71% of UKIP supporters are over 50. As a group, UKIP supporters are by far the oldest of any political party in Britain. The ideas that Farage champions, like freedom and self-reliance, are old-fashioned values. UKIP represents the noble ideals of another era, but it's also burdened with some of its prejudices. Voters who grew up in the 1940s and 50s were born into a very different world. Britain was full of pasty people with mousy hair, called Gordon and Mary. Foreigners were queer folk who lived abroad. Many of this generation are disconcerted by the opening up of the world, by the fluidity of movement which globalization brings. They yearn for stability and the familiar. They do not think of their own views as racist, though a younger generation might.
Thank you very much. Excellent.
When Farage arrives at the conference, he's swamped by the press. Dozens of TV crews have come from Europe and the rest of the world. They're all interested in the future of the EU.
How come there isn't a black face on this program?
Except Michael Crick from Channel 4 News, who repeatedly asks why there are no black faces on a UKIP leaflet.
Black face on the front of it. Is that an oversight?
Farage manages to give him the slip when he sneaks out of a side door for a fag.
There have been weasels all through the course of history.
Farage has made a point of rejecting political correctness.
It was quite restrained there.
With the world's press waiting to interview him, he decides to head round the corner for a drink. But when Farage disappears, experienced hacks know where to look. Crick appears again, leaflet in hand, and hounds Farage out of the pub and down the street.
Black face on the front of it. How come there isn't a black face on this photograph? Yes, right.
Yes. Farage simply ignores him. But then Crick tries the same stunt with UKIP MEP Godfrey Bloom, who is less restrained.
Disgraceful! You're disgraceful!
What?
It's enough to get Crick his scoop. A silly incident which, a few months ago, Farage might have laughed off. But as he gets closer to real political power, he's becoming less forgiving of the eccentric outbursts of his supporters.
To slap someone on the head.
Within hours, Bloom is forced to resign.
Do you think that's acceptable, Mr. Godfrey?
This wasn't his first misdemeanor.
To apologize for your comment.
He recently referred to what is now known as the developing world as Bongo Bongo Land.
Why are you not going to resign of this, Mr. Bloom?
Nor is Bloom the first to be expelled. Candidates have been kicked out for making racist comments, and one for suggesting that the recent floods were God's judgment on gay marriage. UKIP party membership is rising fast, recently passing the 34,000 mark. But as it grows, the beast gets harder to control.
UKIP is the most independent-minded body of men and women who have ever come together in the name of British politics. But that does present occasional difficulties. But if the choice is between our being browbeaten through political correctness to stay within the current received wisdoms, or to be a party of free debate, then be in no doubt, we must be a party of radical alternatives and of free speech.
But sacking Godfrey Bloom and others has not silenced his critics. It's January, and Farage is on his way to Thanet to visit UKIP supporters. But they're not the only ones who've come to see him.
Such a loving, hate-stirring, stomach-turning, nasty little Nigel!
Animal rights activists have been joined by the Kent International Socialists.
They're racist, they're homophobic, they're everythingist, basically. They're just frightened of absolutely everything, and they try and spread fear and hatred throughout the population.
500 million people a year is too much. It's about to get worse. We're about to open the door to the whole of Bulgaria and Romania.
Let's get Nigel out of this town.
It means an open door to the criminal gangs and modern-day pagans.
99% of them come here to work, but he does not let them do that at all. And he is so nasty.
Behind the facade is a man who I fear has a visceral loathing of people he defines as outsiders.
When Farage arrives, things get out of hand. Like Michael Crick, he gets a thwack on the head. He's been depicted as another Hitler, His supporters, according to David Cameron, are fruitcakes, lunatics and secret racists.
Cameron was right. When he said, you know, the closet racists, the loonies, but I think that's too kind. This is a group we should be incredibly worried about.
Do you think that Farage is a racist?
Of course he's not a racist. People who oppose immigration are not racist per se.
I know Nigel for 20 years. I've known him well for 20 years. I've never heard him utter anything that can be described as a racist sentiment in any context, ever.
So let's give him a warm Thanet welcome. Here he is!
Farage is walking a fine line. His anti-immigration policy has won him support, especially among older voters. But if he or his party is deemed to be racist, it's electoral suicide.
Parties that are obviously racist have never done well in this country.
The BNP, or the National Front, have been around for decades. They got destroyed every election, every single election. So if you are a racist-based party, you're done for. Farage cannot be, knows he can't be, and wouldn't want to be a racist party. However, there are people in our country who think that immigration is one of our problems. He represents that groupage.
We've confused and muddled immigration, i.e. people coming to settle, with people coming to work. They become...
If Farage gets his way, future immigrants will need a work visa. They will have to support themselves and their families for 5 years before being eligible for welfare benefits, free healthcare or free education.
At the end of the 2 years, if I haven't left, they'll deport me. It's quite simple.
Your policies on immigration appeal to the darker side of the sentiments of the British public, the fear of the outsider and so on. What do you say to that?
I've always said we as a party are not opposed to immigration. We're not opposed to immigrants. But what we do say is there are a lot of jobs being done in this country by people, mostly from Europe, that frankly should be being done by our own people.
But I don't believe immigrants come to Britain to claim the dole or steal jobs. They come to do jobs that British people on the dole won't do. Nor can outsiders be blamed for the real problems we face. Our runaway public spending, ballooning national debt, and failing state health system. Farage's wish to limit immigration directly contradicts his own views on freedom. He loves globalization and free world trade, yet wishes to limit the free movement of people. John Stuart Mill will be rolling in his grave.
UKIP and Farage have gone wrong here. They've embraced the same incorrect protectionist views that they rightly deride in other areas and have applied them to immigration.
I radically disagree with his thought process that immigration should be curbed. Let them all come. Let them all come. Yeah, there will be people who take advantage of us, but in the end of the day, there'll be more that bring value to our country.
You can't pass a law to block some people from coming here and think that's going to make us all richer. It won't make us richer. In fact, it will end up making us poorer and less competitive.
Coming up, trouble up north, and Farage meets the knobs at the Savoy. Nigel Farage, so many years on the margins, now finds himself at the centre of things. He's at London Savoy Hotel for a big media event attended by the great and the good. They want to give Farage an award for Political Insurgent of the Year. Even Michael Crick is here, in a mellow mood.
The indestructible Nigel Farage.
Well, thank you very much indeed. I don't normally attend events like this. The reason is I'm never invited. And actually, I've never won a prize in my life, because it isn't just in politics that I'd be considered to be a bit of a clown or a fruitcake or an eccentric. I've been really fighting against the establishment at school and in business and in politics, so it's my first ever prize. I know that nearly all of you in the room despise UKIP, and that's absolutely fine by me. And I'm jolly well going to make sure that in the European elections, even more of you despise me, UKIP, and the many millions that are going to vote for us. Thank you.
It's the Tory party conference in Manchester. Farage has been banned, despite being asked to speak at a fringe meeting by the Eurosceptic Bruges group. Rather than disinviting him, an alternative venue has been hired in Manchester Town Hall. There's a throng of press and TV reporters, and they all want to know one thing. Is Farage prepared to enter an electoral pact with the Tories?
I've had endless Tories say to me, Farage is going to win the next election for Miliband. And I say to them, I think truthfully, no, you are going to win the next election for Miliband, because you could end Farage and UKIP tomorrow by embracing the things that Farage embraces.
Sharing the platform with Farage is the Tory Eurosceptic MP Bill Cash, who does not want to be photographed shaking his hand.
Well, it's up to you, Du Bois. If you want to treat me like Cameron does, that's entirely up to you.
Cash has been doing his sums. He thinks the surge in support for UKIP will cost the Tories the next election.
What worries me, this is not rocket science. This doesn't require a mathematical genius. It may be as many as 60 marginals that could go as a result of their intervention.
Cash wants some kind of Tory-UKIP pact, but Farage's supporters in the audience are dead against it.
You don't want any coalitions, Nigel. Be careful, we're watching you.
Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Nigel Farage.
Farage turns on Cash and the Tory Eurosceptics for supporting John Major, the man who signed the Maastricht Treaty.
The ultimate test. You failed the test. You failed the test. You put your party before this country. I'm sorry, Bill. You didn't frankly have the balls to put country before party. And that's why UKIP exists. We are not just a subset, a rump of the Tory Eurosceptics. We've become far more than that. There isn't going to be a deal between us and the Conservative Party at the next general election. That is impossible. And it would not be in the national interest, frankly, to put Mr. Cameron back in office when he believes in continued membership of the European Union. I'm sorry, Bill, the world has moved on, and the best way to change British politics is from without and not from within.
The predictions could be wrong. The threat to the Tories from UKIP may be overstated. But some commentators are beginning to sound apocalyptic.
Nigel Farage is the worst thing that could have happened to the Tory party, because in the short term he has destroyed them. He has rendered them almost unelectable.
David Cameron's watching right now. Dave, the game is already up. It's too late. You didn't want to be the leader of the, quotes, nasty party, and now you're not going to be leader of any party.
It's January, and I'm with Farage in Withenshaw, on the outskirts of Manchester. UKIP are fighting a by-election here. Their candidate, who grew up on a council estate, is a former Labour supporter. Farage is here to lend a hand.
Hello there. How are you? All right?
You're okay, thanks, Nigel.
In northern constituencies like this, UKIP poses a threat to Labour in a way the Tories never did, for one simple reason. Of all the major political parties in Britain, UKIP has the highest proportion of working-class supporters. And Farage is going down well with the locals on the high street.
Hello, how are you? All right?
Going for a drink, then?
Listen, they're open in 20 minutes.
Don't underestimate the number of working-class voters who have had it up to here with Labour.
There's no question that a significant part of the UKIP vote comes from disenchanted Labour voters who previously had nowhere to go.
Right. That woman said to me, haven't you gone for a drink yet?
Is there a danger that voters in Labour areas who wouldn't ever dream of voting Tory might consider UKIP?
There may be one or two, but it's also a matter of people looking at their own living condition and that of their families and communities, and deciding whether they really believe that their futures are safeguarded by voting UKIP.
So why do you think you're taking votes from Labour?
In towns and cities throughout the North, since the year dot, have been Labour-controlled councils, and people don't see any change. The North lived under the dead hand of nationalisation, And when that ended, there was a huge dependency on government benefits and a lack of incentive for people to go out and find work.
And
that's changed. We've got an older generation that feels let down, and we've got a younger generation who aren't prepared to put up with it anymore.
And they don't believe the state is the solution.
They don't believe the state's solution. They believe in thinking for themselves and having a better life. That's what everybody wants.
My party, the Labour Party, has got to understand that what they're arguing in Islington does not accord with the view in Middlesbrough or Keighley.
Everything they say, absolutely everything they say, is contemptible to me.
He's the man to vote for. All right.
The fact that working class people are now attracted to this lot kind of just totally depresses me.
The Euro elections in several weeks' time could change the political landscape. Farage wants more than to take Britain out of the EU. He's setting out to destroy the cosy dominance of the Tories and Labour.
We are now changing the face of British politics.
I am so contemptuous of what this establishment has done that if it takes a revolution, then so be it.
I think the idea of voting UKIP is seen as something respectable, a little bit radical, and I think a lot of people will be doing it.
The 2015 general election becomes unreadable and unpredictable, which is incredibly exciting.
Big progress, of course we're happy.
What has to happen between now and the elections that are coming up is that the media has to be kind of controlled in terms of how often Farage gets to rule the airwaves. I think we should be very, very worried.
To have this thrust on it, this mantle of greatness, that you could be a major power source in British politics. It's an astonishing moment.
I set out to find the fascinating hidden Farage behind the bloke with a pint, but there isn't one. He is as he was as a boy, bolshy, perverse, and normal. He has the normal views of normal people of an older generation.
We want our country back.
Yes, of course we do.
Quite right.
He has their normal prejudices, disquiet at the pace of change in the world, and when confronting a problem, a tendency to unfairly blame outsiders rather than ourselves or the state. But he has their normal admirable values too, of self-reliance, a love of free trade, free speech and genuine democracy, a suspicion of bureaucrats and experts, and a wish to see the government leave us with more of our own money. And, depending on who you ask, the astonishing popularity of this normal man is either terrifying or terrific.